going to be over 120,000 Allied soldiers fighting their way onto a French beach in the name of all that is good and pure in this world. Those men are going to need air support. That support will not make it through Jerry's defenses if we do not get that tower down by 0600. So what do you have to do?
Our goddamn job, Sergeant!
That's right. Your goddamn job.
Corporal Ford here has joined as our explosives expert. You are lucky to have him. You will obey his commands as if you heard my old beautiful voice coming from his lips.
Our drop is 90 minutes out. Kerhi!
Kerhi!
We interrupt this program to bring you a special report.
Won't you come see about me?
This is Cheap Seat Reviews.
Well, hello, and thank you for listening to Cheap Seat Reviews, the podcast that explores the Hollywood film industry for the greater good.
The greater good.
This is episode 284. And tonight we're talking about Overlord. I am Sean Allred, as Sam already yelled out. And joining me tonight is Andrew, All Americans Play Baseball, Jimison.
Yeah. That is right. They all play the baseball. And they also all play with the balls. So it's a guy thing.
Yeah. Okay. That's good. Yeah. You're not wrong. Sam uses a flamethrower to cook his food, Vector.
Hey, Sean.
Hey.
Hey, Sean. I've got this. It kind of looks like a marshmallow here. I need you to open your mouth really, really wide.
No. Oh, okay.
And put this in your mouth. And don't mind the duct tape I've got in my left side here, or my left hand. So just open wide for me, buddy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Anyway, yes, so this is a movie, 2018's Overlord, starring...
Did this go straight to video, or was this out in the movie?
I don't remember it in theater.
Do you?
I do.
I don't remember it in the theater.
I think it was in theater. Okay. Yeah, it was in theater, and opening weekend, it didn't make a lot of money. I mean, it only made $41 million.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so it didn't make a lot of money at all. I mean, it only cost $38 million, but... Yeah.
Ouch.
Yeah.
Hey, but it made money though, right?
It did make $3 million, which is basically
more than I've got in my bank account.
Well, you're not wrong.
If I'm going to shell out 38, I'd hope to make a little bit more than that percentage on that
money. Yeah, I'm curious as to why, and maybe it didn't have a wide
release.
It
had JJ attached to it. So,
it did. It was
it's got some sort of clout.
Yeah, and that's why I remember seeing it when I first saw it, and I thought, ooh. Okay, it's a JJ production. You know, maybe it's going to be in the same kind of vein as the Cloverfield universe. I mean,
well, is it? Do we consider this in the Cloverfield universe?
It is not. It's in the trivia that he specifically said not part of Cloverfield.
Why not? It could fit, right? It didn't mean they've changed history or anything.
I guess. I don't know. I mean, Cloverfield's been about aliens, not about zombies. So I would assume that.
Yeah.
It would be not that. Okay. So anyway,
true.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Okay. Jeez.
Maybe Nazis are aliens.
Oh, jeez.
Well, we've proved that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Yes, that's true. In a few weeks ago, we did prove that Nazis are aliens.
Those are creatures. Yeah.
Yeah. So Andrew, if you will, please tell us what is the movie Overlord.
Well, see, Overlord is this film that was made in 2018.
You've been with us.
About a small group of American soldiers who find horror behind enemy lines on the eve of D-Day.
Oh my gosh. You've been with us for almost 200 episodes and it's still.
Well, you have no proof I didn't have that ready. I was right there on it.
No, okay.
Did I vamp a little? Mm-hmm. Maybe, but 2 seconds later I had it.
Okay. Fine. So. Yes.
So they drop our paratroopers in, right?
Yeah.
To destroy a tower to help the landing forces.
Mm-hmm. Correct? Yeah, that's the thing.
Okay, so that was the basis, and then they just so happened to, you know, find some pretty crazy experimentation going on in France.
Yeah. Well, we knew that there was experimentation done by the Nazis on people. We knew that. That's not a foreign thing. But most of the
they aren't Americans.
Well, yeah, okay.
So it would be a foreign thing.
Oh, yeah, I understand. But I didn't know where you're going with that. But yeah, you're not wrong.
He's not wrong.
No.
Yeah, see?
You know, right. But most of it, from what we understand, or at least from what I understand, reading from books and things, was that it was about mostly trying to find the genes that made blonde hair, blue eyes, so that they could genetically...
they could reproduce that.
Yeah, just so that we would all look the same, I guess.
Although I read an article today that said that they were also looking to reestablish the German... historical German countryside or some weird stuff like that. So it's like they were looking for some extinct cattle and things as well.
Sure, that sounds fun.
So, yeah, anyway, I just thought that was interesting.
Yeah. No, that sounds terrifying.
Not as terrifying as... Oh, wait.
Oh, well, you're going to give it away as... Well, let's go ahead and do our 5-word reviews, and we'll get into the meat of this movie, because there's kind of a lot to chew on this movie, because it's not as forward facing as you might think it is.
Yes.
Yeah. Yep. So
not quite what you think.
Yeah, go ahead, Sam.
All right. My first 5-word review is seen this, but without zombies.
Okay.
And then my other one is darker Captain America origin story.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Okay.
It's basically same thing. It's just, you know, only this is the Nazis have the serum and we don't. And then somehow we get it.
Yeah. Dr. What's his name? Oh, gosh. I can't think of his name. I can't think of the actor's name. No, that's funnier than what I can think.
Sabago.
Sure. Whoever he is, I can't think of his name, but he's the one. He gets this serum and sneaks it to America and then makes it better, and then thus we have Captain America. Totally. I'm with you. Right.
Yeah. I like it. It works.
So keep going, man. Like, what'd you think? Did you like it? Did you not?
You know, to tell you the truth, I went into this thing, again, a little bit kicking and screaming. And you know, the crazy thing is I love my World War II movies, mm-hmm. and I love my zombie movies. So I don't know why I was coming into this kicking and screaming. But I started this thing this afternoon on my phone in the bedroom, because obviously you cannot watch this in front of small children.
Yeah.
And I got to the point where I wanted to keep watching. I was a little disappointed that I had to stop several times to do other things. Not that it's a really good film, and because it's not. It's just it's an interesting, fun film to me. I enjoyed the heck out of this thing. It's obviously rehashed. It's obviously something that we've seen before, but I don't care. I still had a bunch of fun with all the tropes, because this was Tropicana galore everywhere. And it was also, I thought it was also fairly well done. And, you know, from the very beginning, aircraft, the whole plane scene, I thought was amazingly done.
Yeah.
I thought it was a really fun, good little flick. fairly well done.
Yeah.
Now, were there some stupid stuff in it? The whole him getting into the truck with the bodies because he was being chased by a wolf. I mean, come on. I mean, that was, I kind of rolled my eyes at that a little bit.
Yeah. I mean, we needed to find a way to get him into the fort.
Yeah. And I was sitting there thinking, man, they could have needed to figure out a different way there somehow, some shape or form to get him in the little underground bunker. You know, at times there was much, how can you say it? He was like, oh gosh, what's the game that you sneak around in?
I got Black Snake in my head. What's his name? Metal Gear Solid. There it is.
Metal Gear Solid, right?
Yeah, that's so what you're
going
for.
It felt a little bit contrived with that, but I don't care. It was still a lot of fun, and I kind of like the way they did the, you know, they call them zombies, right? But they're not really.
I don't think they ever used that word.
Zombies. Never used that word.
Wasn't that in the description?
No.
Wasn't that?
Not the one I read. It was.
No. Find horror behind enemy lines. No.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, okay. That word's well, never used.
I thought it was a. It had been listed as a zombie movie. No. My bad.
No, it's fine. Oh.
I blame Sean.
No, it's fine.
I was trying to find something. You're very distracted.
You know, I kind of am, and I'm sorry, but basically, like, there's two points in the movie that kind of bug me because of the historical... It's a World War II movie, right? And yes, there's zombies, which makes it very, very, very fiction. I totally get that.
This puts it into Inglourious Basterds territory.
Yes. But I still feel like we should follow some rules, and I'm trying to find one of the rules and that they break. I think that they break. And if I'm wrong, I'd love to know it. But I'm pretty sure that men that were... You can't be drafted to be a paratrooper. I was very, very sure that that was volunteer service only.
Okay.
You know...
A major issue.
It bothered me because I didn't get a lot of clips from this movie because there's not a lot of clips. I mean, there's a lot of whispering. There's a lot of French being spoken, and then there's just a lot of yelling with F-bombs. There's not much quality dialogue. And literally one of the clips I captured was he's like, you know, a guy showed up with a piece of paper and now I'm here. Like, I don't think they were conscripting people for the paratroopers. You know what I'm saying? Like, it annoyed. In a movie with zombies, it literally took me out of the movie because I wanted to stop and do some research, and that's what I've been doing for the last minute.
And see, that's not what this is, though.
I know, but don't put the line in if it's not. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's what annoys me. And the other thing that kind of bothered me, I don't know if bothered is the right word.
Lazy, you thought?
I guess. I mean, we're trying to. He's obviously the reluctant hero, right? I mean, he's that trope. He's the reluctant hero. He doesn't want to fight. In fact, the only person he physically kills is technically a zombie.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Like, he doesn't actually kill anyone, technically.
No. So no, I'm even going back to when he was in the town. He was never one of the guys that. Opened fire on the car people.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. Like, the only time he shoots his weapon is when he's shooting zombified the colonel or whatever he was.
Yeah.
And then he also kills the dude from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. But again, he's already technically dead. Okay. Let's just go ahead and get this other part out of the way that also annoyed me. And I'm going to Google it real quick, but. It annoyed me again, so I apologize. But
see, I totally, literally flew past that in terms of recruitment. I was like, I don't care.
I know, I know I shouldn't. I know I shouldn't care, but I do. Mm-hmm. It just bothers me. The other part that annoyed me was the sergeant. The African American sergeant.
Okay.
We weren't integrated like that.
Well, yeah, that I thought I'd say something about that, but I didn't want to step on any toes or anything, but you're right. I was like, this is the era of Tuskegee Airmen, and it just, that didn't happen. Unfortunately,
yeah,
that did not happen.
No, I don't think you're, there's no toes to step on. I mean, this just, yeah. it is the way it is. You know, there were black regiments. They were, you know, Tuskegee Airmen, which is the most decorated fighter group in the history of warfare. And their accolades are amazing. They never lost.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, they didn't lose. They never lost a bomber to enemy planes. Obviously, they can't protect them from flak, but not one of their bombers that they flew escort for was ever shot down. I mean, what they did was amazing, and there were certainly lots of cases of you know, black men serving in the Navy, but mostly as, you know, cooks and things like that. But unless there's some strange obscure thing, you know, moment in history I'm unaware of, but there never would have been a black sergeant in charge of white men. You know what I'm saying? It wouldn't have happened.
And let's double say, unfortunately, that's the case.
Well, yeah.
This film basically glosses over that. Oh, Peanut, is something wrong with his back left leg?
She's only had three working legs for like two years.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. Sorry.
Sorry, folks. The dog just walked by. crap. Now I lost my train of thought.
Black Sheriff, yeah.
Do you think this was a Hollywood producer kind of coming into the storyboard room and like, we need this, or we need to change this about this type of deal? Or
I think the only thing that I can think of that makes sense from a story point of view is it almost makes me feel like that we're showing an alternate history.
Mm-hmm.
Where blacks aren't treated the way they are in our history.
Okay.
You know, like, this is a parallel universe where we're all just people, right? You know, the sergeant's just the sergeant, because they give him grief, not because our hero, boys, they don't give him a hard time because he's black. They give him a hard time because he's soft.
Yeah.
You know, like, it's never brought up. They never use any, you know, racial slurs. He says, you almost didn't make it out of camp. And it's because they find out it's because he's soft, that he wouldn't kill a rat. Yeah. You know, so it almost makes me think that this movie is just a parallel universe where
they didn't even go there. They never went there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
About that kind of stuff. Now, of course, it's human experimentation, all that sort of stuff. Certainly it could be. But. Right.
But like, you know, the other thing too is like, well, the movie does the other thing that we have done as a Hollywood society over the last few years, is there is no Nazi symbolism, symbology. There's no Nazi symbols. That's the word I'm looking for.
Oh yeah.
In the movie, like the swastika has been taken. There's no swastika. They use other forms to let you know that that's, you know, that they're definitely, you know, Nazis, but they've taken that out, which is, again, totally fine with. I'm all for it. So anyway, those are, again, honestly, in a movie that's kind of this silly and kitschy and weird, those are my main problems. And so I guess if I use the mindset that it's an alternate universe, okay, fine, then I'm good with it. All right, cool. You know, like, well, that's just fine.
Yeah.
So we'll move on. So the movie doesn't really have any actors that I've really ever heard of, honestly. And maybe that's part of the problem, you know? I mean,
well, but isn't that pretty much the non-directed JJ films type of thing, though?
Yeah.
You know, if JJ doesn't direct it, don't they kind of hold off on being big name people?
I don't know.
Cloverfield, right?
Okay. Yeah. Well, let's. Okay. I'm picking up what you're laying down. I don't know the answer. Yeah. I don't know if you're right. I like what your idea here. I'm trying to find where I can click on JJ's name and go through some of his. Because you're right. I mean, there were some people that eventually became kind of famous in Cloverfield.
Yeah. While you're looking, that didn't bother me having
Oh, it didn't bother me either.
I thought they did a really good job.
Yeah. I thought they were great actors. And I mean, even the kid, I thought, did a pretty good job.
No, yeah. Okay. Sorry. Let me make sure I'm being clear. It didn't bother me that there was no one in it. I'm thinking maybe that's why it didn't do as well in the theater, because there was
a draw of a brand name.
Yeah.
Maybe star power.
Yeah. This was solely banked on JJ as a producer. Right. You know, it's not like it starred John Boyega as the guy. You know what I'm saying? Like, you put him in this in 2018.
Well, after, that would have been good.
I'm saying after the success of Star Wars. Now you've got
busy, though.
Yeah, he was busy. He was doing some stuff. I don't know what it was, but it's something. But, I mean, the only other dude that I recognized... Now, Sam, you recognized a couple of guys from Game of Thrones, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Well,
and there was also the scrawny American, the one who made friends with the kid. I've seen him in other things as well.
The guy that was always yelling,
The kid.
Yeah, the Irish kid. Yeah, go get a John Magaro. Yeah, I've seen him in such films as, he's in The Orange Is the New Black. He was in Umbrella Academy.
Umbrella Academy. That's
trying to think what I know him from, because I've seen him. Oh, he was in Unbroken, which I saw.
What was he in Unbroken?
Tinker? I don't know. Just one of the dudes.
Not Unbreakable. Unbroken.
Unbroken. Okay. Yeah. The World War II movie where the dude doesn't break, I guess. He's in Captain Phillips. I have seen the movie. It's a really good movie. Oh, he's also...
And by the way, I am still interested in hearing what you guys, your five-word reviews.
Oh, yeah.
What you think.
Oh, yeah. Andrew, go do yours. I'm sorry. Yeah. Totally forgot we still do that part.
It's okay.
I'm out of it.
Okay, mine is this. A futile exercise in turd polishing.
Oh.
No, I'm kidding. Wow. That's not mine. Oh, I found that online.
I was about to say, man, you know, speak your mind here, buddy.
No. I found that online. I actually disagree with that one 100%.
Oh, wow. Okay, good.
Yeah. I don't know what it was. Which, by the way, I didn't have a five-word review because I just couldn't think of one. So I stole that one from the internet because I liked it. But it's not my thoughts at all. I mean, I had no idea what this was about. I didn't even look at the poster. Like, I just clicked on it and I was watching it. And so I never heard of it, never saw the previews, never trailer, nothing. And this movie had me hooked from the very beginning. Like, I didn't look away.
That plane scene was what really was amazing.
Yeah.
I just thought it was really, at least that part of it was really well done. Now, there was some of it that was a little off here and there, and maybe wasn't the best. But it didn't bother me. Let's put it that way.
Yeah.
I was still in this movie. And I knew while I was watching it that there were things that didn't quite fit. I thought, well, it kind of takes me out of it a little bit. But at the same time, I didn't care. Like, I just, I was having fun with it. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if this one just caught me in the right mood or what. But I kind of caught on, you know, when you see the aunt. Right away, I kind of caught on then that something was a little up. I didn't catch it with the breathing, and maybe I should have, because I've seen The Walking Dead like 12 times. But after you see her for the first time, you know right away that, okay, this is about zombies, or something of that sort.
She sounds like a zombie. She really does.
Yeah, she does.
Like, and I should have caught
a soundtrack for zombies. Then that's definitely what you hear coming out of that room,
right? But sure. You know, I just loved every minute of this. I really did. I thought it was fantastic. The last, I don't know, the last few minutes of the movie, or 10, 15 minutes, I wasn't thrilled with the way it ended necessarily. And I kept waiting for a post-credit scene or a mid-credit scene.
Mm-hmm.
But we never got it.
Yeah, you're not wrong. I was expecting, the shows like the Army Corps of Engineers coming by with bulldozers and stuff and pulling
an
out,
arm.
Pulling out the corporal or pulling out the German guy, like something like that. Yeah, you're not wrong. My 5-word review was just simply moral soldier fights zombie Nazis.
Okay.
I mean, it's kind of what it is. If you kind of boil it down to what it is. Our hero is a good guy. He's truly a good guy. He wants to do the right thing. The corporal is kind of your typical soldier that he's just there to do the job. And
he's the tropey soldier who's seen too much and is ultra violent and will do whatever it takes.
Yeah. Yeah. We're going to torture this guy. That's fine. I mean, we've seen Band of Brothers. We've seen Saving Private Ryan. When you have a squad, there's going to be everyone's got the trope, right? So, you've got, the weak and kind of timid guy. In this case, it was the photographer. In Saving Private Ryan, it was the interpreter, right? Just until the very end. But basically, it's the same dude. You've got our hero that kind of just wants to do the right thing. Well, he's Private Ryan. You've got there's really no one playing the Tom Hanks character,
no,
but
the fatherly, reluctant father.
Yeah. Basically. Yeah. The Tom Sizemore character is kind of the sniper in this movie where all he wants to do is bark and complain and whatever. So anyway, it's tropey. Totally fine with it. I had a good time with the movie.
By the way, Opie, I know you play Battlefield as well as I do. Were you seeing those two in the woods thinking, one's support and one is snipey?
Easy. I don't play Battlefield as well as you do. Okay, no one plays Battlefield as well as you do. I play Battlefield with you.
But weren't you seeing that as a support and sniper?
Yeah. Right? He's on the machine gun and the guy's sniping. And of course he's like, hit those guys. He goes, it's a 2-man gun, you jerk. And it's like, well, I can run it one by myself in my game. I mean, why can't you? So.
I'm not going to lie. I kind of thought about you two when I saw that scene.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. I thought Sam's over there leaned up against the tree. Sean's down there trying to shoot this 2-man gun by himself, calling Sam a jerk.
Yeah.
That's pretty much how we play.
That's actually pretty accurate. In fact, Andrew, we're going to get a little into an inside thing where most people don't care and only matters if you play the game. But on more than one occasion, I'll see Sam lying on the ground sniping, and I'll walk up and throw a smoke grenade right in front of him. So he's like, oh, who threw a smoke grenade? And I'm like, yeah. And then I go running off, and then I'll spawn back in on him, and then fire that smoke grenade. He's like, gosh dang it, Opie. So yeah, that happens pretty often, actually.
It's fun.
Yeah, it's all in good fun. I will say this: we talked about it earlier. So this movie, low budget, relies heavily on practical effects. The practical effects in this movie, I think, are really good. I mean, when that plane is going down, I mean, they built the plane fuselage on a gimbal. And so when the guys are getting sucked out, basically they just turn the plane on its up and just let the guys just fall out through real fire into a pad. But those stuntmen were going through fire down into like a pad or something. I mean, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. And it looked great. It did. I can't give them enough credit because it really did look good.
Yeah, it did. And I mean, the zombie, like the makeup and stuff where when he flips his head back, I mean, that's like puppetry and some makeup and some practical effects.
Really like caught me off guard. Yeah. I don't know if it caught you guys off, but when his head went back, I did a literal gasp out loud.
I find it, I will say this, I find it interesting that the, so the movie basically plays out that once they get into the church, the German that they've been torturing earlier in the movie, he goes back in there and he takes the serum while he's alive. And the doctor, Dr. Schmidt, is like, no, don't do that. We don't know what they'll do to you. And it, then he basically turns into Abomination, right, from MCU. And
he took two vials of different serums.
He jabbed himself twice, And so they get in, and then, of course, they're fighting him, and he's beating the crap out of the corporal. And he puts him up on a fish hook, which is really gnarly. That gave me heartburn just watching it. And then the corporal gets down and he looks over and there's another one of those syringes with the goo in it. And so then, of course, he stabs himself so that he can have the fight. But I found it interesting, and maybe just the plot needed it to, but he was more aware of who he was as, and maybe, okay, actually, you know what? Now that I think about it, I know why. It's because he took the injection while he was alive. That's the difference. When photographer man took it, when he got stabbed, he was dead. So he basically just came back as a zombie. You know, he woke up.
Although he was pretty cognizant of who he was for a little bit before.
It
was still fresh.
He didn't take long for him to turn full zombie. Whereas the corporal, I mean, he was aware enough that he was like, hey, here's a lighter, you know, you need to go, I got this, you know, I'm going to take out this fool with the C4, it's your job to go do it. You know what I'm saying? Like, he played the hero until the end, which was cool. I'm kind of glad, honestly, I'm kind of glad the movie did that. I know it's a little by the book, but you know what I'm saying? Like, it wasn't like he defeats the German and then he goes and turns on Boys and then Boys has to kill him. You know what I'm saying? Then I think the movie's a little too hard at that point emotionally on us. I think keeping it is kind of safe where he makes a sacrifice play and he gets to die a hero because then he goes back to Boyce goes back to his commander and says, this is what happened. You know, and of course he kind of glosses over obviously the zombie part because they would throw him in a mental institution if he said that they were the zombies down there. So I had a good time with this. I think I'm with you guys. This was fun. I don't.
This was one of those rare films that is just. Yeah. It was a good time. It was what you go to the movies to do.
Yeah.
You know, it was a blast.
It pushed in some areas, that, you know, your normal fun movie doesn't push in. Like, you know, Sam says this is fun, and I agree. And I think I even may have used those words too, but it also is quite disturbing in some other.
Although there's a lot of movies that you guys would agree with me here that I say is fun that should not be fun.
right.
Yeah. Yeah.
So yeah, no, you know, it happens.
So I will say that the only time that I laughed out loud, really laughed out loud is. I love the bit where they strapped that dude to the motorbike and forced him to ride into
and his head explodes.
Now I will say this:
just a split second before everything else, but his head explodes.
I'll say this in the moment. Now I'm thinking about it. It doesn't really work because in real life. You know, there's no incentive for him to actually go into his base to commit suicide and homicide because he knows what's going to happen.
His hands are tied, though.
His hands are tied to the handlebars, but he
thinks that somehow they can prevent him from blowing up.
You think so? He thinks that there's going to be a way that he can
maybe.
Can pull the tape off, spit the grenade out. Because I wondered about
that. When I saw that, I was like, well, why would he purposely drive into the base?
Yeah, he should stop at the bridge. You know what I'm saying? Like, I guess if they showed, and maybe there was no practical way to do it, you know, it showed his hand, like the throttle taped down so that, like, he comes through the gate and then crashes into a car. And like,
but here's the problem with a motorcycle. You can use your arms to go either way.
Yeah. I mean, right? Yeah, exactly. That's my point. Like
I kind of thought of that exact same thing on there when it's like, I didn't care.
In the moment I laughed, I was like, oh, that's actually kind of brilliant. You know, they turned him into a bomb. I mean, it was fun. And the way he just, once he realizes his time's up, he just kind of like has a sad face. You know, I would have spit the grenade out. I know I'm going to die, but at least I'm not going to get my head blown off.
Do you think he could, though? I mean, maybe, is it so big that it won't?
Oh, I don't know. Maybe, yeah.
I've never swallowed a grenade, so yeah, that's true. I wouldn't know.
Just go,
but yeah. maybe that is it, you know, where it's just too big. It's like having so many marshmallows in your mouth, you can't spit them all out at once.
Sure. Okay, I got you. Yeah. It still made me laugh.
I've got this grenade over here, Sean.
Sure.
Can you open up wide for me?
Yeah, I got
there was a penis joke in there somewhere, and yeah, I was trying to find it, but I couldn't.
You're not wrong.
I'm kind of angry.
If Corny were here, he would have found a way to figure that out.
Oh gosh, yeah.
I honestly, the only other note that I wrote down was that we all saw Chase dying by the prisoner, right? Like, we all saw that happening. You know, they send the weakest, meekest guy upstairs to make sure that he's ready to...
And you don't do that. For God's sake, you just don't do that.
You don't, yeah. I mean,
right.
That corporal, for as experienced as he was, he would know that you take two guys up there.
Right.
One to keep a gun on. Yeah, it was dumb. It was just—it was a dumb way to kill the kid. I know. I just, I thought the guy did a pretty good job on his American accent though, because he's very British. I think there's a lot of British actors in this because the main dude was British. Obviously,
Chase was or a kid was British.
Boys was British.
Chase
is British. Obviously, Chloe's French. The German guy is actually German. Tibbet, who was the Italian guy, he is from Ohio.
So he's British.
Okay.
Well, this was all filmed in England.
Yeah, it was all filmed in England, yeah. Chase is, he's from, he's in our Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Oh, he's from Scotland.
Scotland?
Yeah. He's known for Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and this movie.
Okay.
And apparently he's also, he's in Us. Oh, TV miniseries Us. Oh, interesting.
Was anybody else freaked out when Jacob had this, like, it would look like a huge vacuum hose just stuck in his gut?
Right?
Yeah.
And I thought when he pulled it out, I don't know if you've ever seen it, but there's these things where the farmers actually have a plug that they cut a hole out of the cow and they reach their hand.
You can put your hand right into the stomach. Yeah.
That's kind of what I was expecting. And I kind of wish it had been something more grotesque like that. Because when he starts pulling it out, it's just one needle and a couple of other little prongs. I thought, well, that's not as bad as I thought.
Why would you put your hand in the cow of a stomach?
Well, and you see, when he first gets there, you know, you see the side view of him laying in the cot and you see the kind of the wear and tear of his skin around that thing.
Yeah.
So I thought that thing had to have been more connected than it was.
Gross.
But it was pretty nasty.
Yeah. By the way,
I do need a point of clarification.
Yeah.
Okay. So we're told that all of this is in France and it's happening at the basement of a church. And I think the German guy said that they've always had this, and it took the Germans to push it forward.
Mm-hmm.
Did I get that right?
Yeah.
So this sickness or whatever it is has always been there.
Well, I mean, it's France. If you've ever been down in the metro, it's filthy.
I mean,
who knows what's growing down there?
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of like the same thing in Captain America, right, when they go and get the Tesseract, like it was in this little village somewhere that has a secret. Mm-hmm. It's kind of the same thing, I think. It's like there's something there in the basement, and yeah, so.
I'm not saying that it's a bad thing. I'm just saying I was trying to figure out what was there before. The church was there. The tower was new, right?
No, I think that was, I think you're right. I think that was always there. It's old. I mean, honestly, the reason
No, there was two towers. If you notice, there was the old church tower, and then there was a metal antenna tower.
Yeah, right, they built the antenna. Yeah, they built the radio tower kind of next to, on top of the church. With in the movie, at the beginning of the movie, the sergeant asks, why do they do it? And he doesn't have an answer, and he's like, it's because they're some bitches. Well, no, they did it because they know that Americans won't bomb a church.
Yeah.
On purpose. So that's why.
Unless, you know, you want to destroy World Heritage Sites in the Oval Office. But, you know, hopefully there's people that'll say no to that.
Are you suggesting something, Sam?
No, I'm just saying that, you know, if there was ever somebody not in the right mind that would threaten heritage sites.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
I'm hoping that our military officers would kind of skirt that notion.
Ah, okay.
And kind of table it, you know, wait another 4 years or so. And
Yeah. Okay.
I'm just going through some of the cast here of the movie, just to see if I recognize anyone, and I don't. But I'm just, you know, having a good time here. And I click on this one dude because you get towards the bottom of the list, and there's not a lot of people with pictures credits by their names. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so we have this guy, Jorge Leon Martinez.
I love Jorge.
And he is known for Solo, A Star Wars Story. He was also in Ready Player One, and he was in Rogue One.
Nice.
So, yeah, good job, dear guy. But I mean, he's also in The Force Awakens. So maybe he's like buddies with JJ in some weird way.
It's kind of like
he used to wash his car.
Edge of Tomorrow as U.S. UDF dog soldier. Okay. Jack Ryan's Shadow Recruit, which we saw. He's in Fury, which we were supposed to do and then got pulled. He's in Kingsman, Avengers of Ultron as Stark Guest. He was in Rogue Nation as CIA agent. I mean, he's literally his whole career
is all JJ.
But Bohemian Rhapsody as Rhodey, uncredited. Like, the majority of his life is uncredited.
Good for him.
Sounds like a sad life.
Oh.
Yeah, I know. But, kid. I mean, he's still getting paid, so, like, I don't feel that bad for him.
Get credit for your pay.
Well, it just means that he doesn't get a SAG card, because he doesn't have lines. But,
I've had my SAG card since I was in ninth grade.
Nice. I see what you did there. You made another wiener reference. I appreciate that. The lady that played the aunt, boy, she's been in a bunch of stuff. Holy smokes. 123 credits.
Good for her.
Was she a hopping man in this?
Oh, my gosh.
We never got to see her again, right?
Oh, you know what? See, here's the thing. The girl, Chloe's kind of a dick, right? Because...
What?
Well, because like...
No, take that back.
She's awesome. She's French. But she's also kind of awesome and but she does, you know, the plan was to make that dude chase her on the motorcycle. That was the plan. And by doing so, you know, that guy sends those troops up to go kill the ant, which we see kind of happening.
Did we ever really see her get killed, though?
Well, they run upstairs, and then in the window we see machine gun fire. So,
okay, all right. So that's what that was.
Yeah, I kind of hoped that it was a trap. Like, those men went up there to kill the ant, and she either turned fully and ate them, or like the American soldiers were up there to kill those guys so that they could trap the one dude. I was kind of hoping that was what happened.
Yeah,
and maybe that did happen. We just don't know. So maybe it's kind of our hopping man, I guess. I don't know. So anyway, but yeah, she's been
in. Would that be a gimping man?
I don't know.
Oh,
I don't know.
A limping man, I guess.
Oh, and she would have to be our Star Trek connection. So that's kind of cool. The aunt was. I mean, she was Evil Lyn in Masters of the Universe.
Nice.
She is a Cheap Seat Reviews alum, which is pretty cool. I'm trying to see if she's in anything else that we've seen, because, I mean, if you're in that, I mean, come on. So.
You've made it.
You have made it.
Yep.
You really have. So anyway, I don't see anything else that she's done that would be great. Yeah. Star Trek Deep Space Nine is her thing. Well, nice. Good for her. Yeah. Oh, she was also in Xena Warrior Princess and Hercules.
Hercules.
Hercules. She's still acting. She's in something called No Such Thing as Vampires. So, there you go.
All right. Tough acting.
Yes.
Tenactin.
Tenactin. anyway, I'm done with the cast. I only have the two clips. You ready for them, I guess?
Yeah, get them.
All right.
Get
them. Here we go. One, here's the first one.
3 months ago, I was cutting grass in my front yard. And the mailman shows up with a letter from the army. Now I'm here.
Yeah, see. I don't think that's how it works, but that's okay.
But couldn't he have been... in the army, and then he chose to be in the airborne?
I don't think they would have let a black man do it, unless we're going.
Well, I mean,
in this alternate universe,
say he's a honky, right? And he gets a letter from the army.
Did you just say a honky?
Yeah.
Yes, Sam. If he was drafted by the army, and he could have chosen to go into the army. Paratrooper division. You get paid more.
Yeah. So, that's how it works.
So, yeah, that is definitely a thing. I mean, there are certain, you know, if you are drafted, I think if you have certain predilections for things, you know, hey, I'm actually a pretty good mechanic. Oh, okay. Well, then we'll put you in a motorized, you know, division, and maybe you can be the mechanic on a tank or something. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's lots of those.
I've got a death wish, and I like to fall out of burning airplanes.
Yes, yeah, exactly. And I want.
Well, there you go.
Yeah, and if I die, my parents get an extra $100 or something. I can't remember. They talk about that a lot in Band of Brothers, and it's the same division because they say Kurahi, which is what. Well, Band of Brothers, that's all what that is from, they're all from Kurahi. It's the mountain that they have to climb, or the hill they have to climb in Mississippi. It's probably the only hill in Mississippi, but this is the only other thing I captured.
Oh, Private? Did you see anything else when you were down there? There's talk about it. Some kind of crowd lab. If there's anything down there, it's worth us digging through all that rubble. You'd let us know, right?
There you go.
Right?
What if they had gotten down there and they found a lab where they're just testing different types of sauerkraut?
Oh, this one is too spicy.
What is this accent?
Yeah, kind of sound like that.
Accents.
Yeah,
you sound like Apu from Fantasy Island.
Yeah, or like some like a Canadian pretending to do a Mexican accent or something. I don't really know what that was. Like, you speak German. Like, you actually have.
You know exactly what I'm talking about.
So weird.
That was some Norwegian stuff, right there.
I don't know what that is.
I heard a fjord in there.
Oh my gosh!
That's why you guys keep me around.
Speaking of Norwegian, I still love that show. I finished it about a month ago. But Hell on Wheels was so good.
Oh yeah!
And there's a Norwegian in that, but they call him the Swede, but he's from Norway. And so like they'll be insulting him, and then they'll call him a Swede. And he's like, but I'm from Norway, and he's like, yeah, whatever, no one cares. So, anyway,
poor kid.
Yeah, he is a bad dude, and he gets his, but it's
does he get his comeuppance?
He does, but in like this show kind of reminds me of Game of Thrones in the way that like people die in really unremarkable ways. Is that, you know what I'm saying? Like that's kind of how life is sometimes.
Like you get a scratch basically. And
or something like that. Like in his case, he does horrible thing after horrible thing after horrible thing after horrible thing. And then at the end of the movie, he gets it, but I mean, it's like, okay. But like that's how it would have been. You know what I'm saying? Like there's not always going to be this, you know, you get to monologue and do the thing and then there's a clever way. No, he just died.
It just happened.
Yeah.
Poor kid.
Yeah, not poor kid. You watch that show, you're not saying poor kid. You know, like I never watched all of Game of Thrones, but that's like saying to Cersei Lannister, poor kid.
Cersei.
Who did I say? Cersei.
Yeah, Cersei.
Whatever. The shame.
I mean, you feel bad for her when she's doing the walk of shame.
Not really.
Not really?
No.
Wow, you're heartless.
No, I
just kept staring at the bad haircut.
She deserved it.
Yeah.
Every second of it.
That's what you were staring at. Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that while I was choking on the cigarette smoke from outside.
There you go.
That's the one episode of Game of Thrones that I ever saw. And I was lying in a hotel room in Germany, right outside of a lounge for smokers.
Oh, no.
And it had no air conditioning, so I had to open the window or sweat to death. And so it was in Germany, and it was pretty much a gas chamber. No jokes. all jokes aside.
Okay, well,
and that's how we end the show, folks.
Yeah.
And now for some more bad news. Ready?
There we go. Let's get past that.
I mean, look, it's not 1940 anymore.
It's a thing. Yeah.
I only captured two pieces of trivia because there wasn't a lot, but I thought these two were kind of interesting. Wyatt Russell, who played Corporal Ford, is the son of Kurt Russell.
Really?
Who starred in The Thing, a movie with a similar-looking monster.
Kind of see that now that I'm thinking of it.
Yeah, that's kind of cool. I want him to do more things now.
Yeah.
The main guy? Well, not the main guy, but obviously not. He's black.
Wait, did you guys think there was bad acting in this? I thought they all did really well.
I thought they did fine. So. Yeah. I really did. I thought it was fine. At no point... Ooh. So he's going to be, Wyatt Russell, is going to be in the new The Falcon and the Winter Soldier series.
Oh, yeah, I saw that.
As an agent. Agent John Walker.
Johnny Walker Black.
Can I say something that's bothering me about that trailer that came on the Super Bowl?
Yeah.
You've got Falcon throwing the shield right at the tree.
Yeah.
I don't see how he can be as strong as Captain America where the shield gets stuck in the tree.
I don't know. I'm with you.
Does that not bother anybody else?
Maybe he found some serum in the serum. Not serum. Serum.
Okay, Charles Barkley. Serum
in the bottom of a church.
I don't know. Maybe they'll explain it, Sam. Maybe it's just the fact that the shield is so awesome it can stick into trees. And if I threw it, it would stick into a tree.
You think so?
No, I'm just saying maybe that's what they're going to say in the movie. I'm not saying, I don't know. WandaVision's obviously going to be some kind of weird thing.
It's her madness is what it's looking like.
Yeah, according to
from her loss, this is going to be the way she copes with the madness.
Yeah. The podcast I listened to today talked about basically it's going to be as weird as Legion was for FX, the...
Nice.
X-Men kind of spin-off show. It's going to be weird. So, I'm looking forward to it. I want to see more of The Falcon and the Winter Soldier. I mean, it's going
to
be
absolutely. I'm still going to watch it. I just thought to myself, wait a minute. Mm-hmm. That doesn't seem right.
Oh, there's only six episodes of that show.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Which
I love that they aren't going to spread it out. Like, if you're going to tell a story, tell it in a compact, perfect way instead of having to tread water.
No, I understand that. I mean, I like that's the way television is going now, is these anthology 6 to 10 to maybe 12 episodes where it's tight.
And I think, honestly, that's why shows like Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. aren't as popular as they could be.
Yep.
Because it is such a drawn-out storyline. Yeah, people get bored easily nowadays.
Yeah, you need – yeah, because – yeah. And so like
– and with the streaming culture, people want to just binge. Take a weekend and binge a show.
Yeah. I mean – yeah, that's why the new Star Trek has been super popular with the Trek fans, because it's like 13 episodes, 12 episodes. We get a really cool story, and we don't have to listen to sit there and watch episodes where Data learned how to play the flute or whatever. You know what I'm saying? Like,
did that happen? Seriously?
Yeah, that happened. Or Data plays the clarinet and Riker's on the trombone and Picard's playing the penny whistle. Like, there's a lot of really bad episodes like that. I mean,
yeah,
and I don't remember Deep Space Nine. I don't remember The Next Gen as much. I mean, in Deep Space Nine, there were also those types of episodes where it's like, okay, we just need a filler episode, right? This is just going to be one of those episodes where the kid and the other kid get into some trouble and they have to get, you know, like, it has nothing to do with anything other than it's expected of us to make a 22-episode season. We only have enough writers and budget for 10 great episodes. So we're going to have 10 great episodes and 5 okay ones. And we need about 5 kind of bad ones. So,
wow.
That's just the way it was.
The idea that's just, I guess, that's filler. That's basically filler.
Yeah. And because Star Trek, specifically.
When did that stop? When did they stop deciding to do that?
Well, I think a lot of it was when streaming came along. I mean, if you look at, some of the first originals, I mean, we still had several series that were pretty long, but not many. And then you look at newer things like The Mandalorian. You've got 8 really well-done episodes.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that if we had more, which we all wanted more, but if we had more, there would probably be some filler in there people would start complaining.
I don't know, to answer your specific question, Sam, is when did we start doing this? I do know that Game of Thrones forced us to turn a corner on that.
Yeah,
that's true.
I think the pivot was, because we had a finite amount of source material with a book, right? And so instead of saying, we're going to take this book and stretch it out to 15 episodes, and then just add crap, we're going to do 10 really tight, good episodes. And then, of course, the end.
Yeah.
We can get to the end later. That's not the point. But I don't know if that was what the first, but it was certainly the most impactful.
And here's the interesting part. I mean, you still have never seen Breaking Bad, right?
Correct.
Correct. Breaking Bad started out as a very, 22 or so episode seasons. Mm-hmm. They were all absolutely amazing. Don't get me wrong. But the last 2 or 3 seasons, I believe the last season was 6 episodes long.
Mm-hmm.
And it was because the writers knew there wasn't much story left and they didn't want to tread water and ruin the incredible momentum they had in this story. And I'm just wondering if that's kind of the start of this, where all of a sudden you've got a huge award-winning popular show stripping down the episodes to maintain its quality.
Yeah, I could see that. That show, it did. That last season, and I don't think that anybody missed anything, if you know what I mean. Like, we wanted more, but what we got was it sustained us.
Yes.
And it was perfect the way that it was. But if you think back to some of the earlier seasons, there was some stuff that I felt like was a little... that we could do without,
Yep. Yep.
But that series is probably, in my opinion, one of the more perfect series that's ever been made.
From beginning to end, it's literally, you might pick out 2 episodes in its entire run where you're like, this isn't all that great.
Yeah.
Well, and another show we could probably name another, a good amount of shows where this is the thing also. Like, West Wing is that way, in my opinion. I mean, there are, even on the episodes where there's not a whole lot happening, there's the dialogue is so good, you don't care.
Until you get to the non-Sorkin years.
But even then, you're still just kind of along for the ride, and you're like, you know what? It's not Sorkin, but you can still tell what they're going for, and it's still good. And so I don't mind any of that. I enjoy it. In fact, I'm actually starting my third run of The West Wing. and this is literally what happened.
Dude, you gotta see Breaking Bad at some point, please. For your own sake. For pop culture sake, try it.
And, it'll be and a treat me, to yourself.
Yeah, you will love it. You will love it.
Okay.
And it's not it's an incredible story, and it's not entirely a downer. And I know that's why it's part of the reason you're probably not watching it, because you're worried about the downer part of it.
How many episodes should I give it?
Should you give it?
Yeah. Let's be honest. You know, like, if I'm not going to just do one episode, but you know, if I watch like five episodes and I'm like, guys, this is just, I'm not into it.
I was in it after about three or four.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like, it had me hooked.
The first episode will be like, ooh, interesting. But it wasn't until.
All right. That's fair.
Until he's starting to deal with what's his name? Andrew, the dealer. The Latino guy.
Tuco.
Yeah. When he starts dealing with Tuco, it gets pretty interesting.
Well, and so in small fairness to me with the West Wing is that, one, just because impeachment is all over the news right now, I thought it was kind of fun to go back and listen to. But literally, I'm treating it almost like a podcast. I put it on Netflix on my phone, and I just stick it in my pocket, and I'm doing stuff around the house or like at work. So it's literally like a podcast, because there's so much dialogue. There's not a lot of visual. You know what I'm saying? I don't need a lot of visual. And the fact that I've now seen it going into this is my third time watching it. I know kind of what their facial, like what's happening on their faces, you know? So like when someone's being yelled at, I kind of know what's happening. So I'm about episode 15. I've probably watched like four. You know what I'm saying?
By the way, I just found an article that says Netflix says this is the episode of Breaking Bad that got you addicted to the show.
Yeah,
they're saying episode two.
Okay.
Episode two, and cool. Andrew, you'll remember that one. All I'll say is bathtub.
Yeah, that was the one.
All right, well, we need to finish this podcast.
Oh, wait, are we doing a podcast?
Excuse me, while I whip this out.
Yeah, we could keep going for a while. Basically, what we're saying is that Overlord is weird, and we like TV shows.
Yeah, we liked it.
I've only watched the first episode of Picard, but it was really good, and I'm looking forward to watching episode two.
I'm going
to
have to see. Someone said it was on YouTube, so I'll have
episode one specifically is on YouTube, and literally I think it goes away in like a couple days. So might have to watch it tomorrow at work, but
or at the conference, I can just pop it up on the Xbox.
Sure. So
yeah,
we decided to do movies with human experiments.
Oh, that's right. We got to do the top three
because there's a lot of that.
We really went down a rabbit hole, didn't we?
Yeah. Well, it's been a while since we've had a really good rabbit chase, so I didn't discourage it, Andrew. Nice.
I have an honorable mention, and I know this is not a physical experimentation.
Sure.
But The Truman Show
is
kind of a human experiment in itself.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's my honorable mention. Number three, I'm going to say The Amazing Spider-Man.
Okay. Yeah, that works.
Yeah. Number two, Deadpool.
Right.
The first one there. Yeah. So we get our avocado having sex with an older, uglier avocado.
but angry sex.
And then my number one, and this might be a little stretch, but I think it fits, The Rise of Skywalker. Because at the end we have the Emperor hooked up to this machine that's keeping him alive, and
And wasn't the big bad in Force Awakens and the second one, wasn't he also some sort of human experiment?
He was a clone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So interesting.
All right.
All right. Well,
side note. I've been doing a lot of these band clinics, you know, and this kid comes up to me at the end of one of the clinics and she running towards me as I'm literally walking to my truck to leave. And she has her phone. She goes, "Here, I need you to see this." And I thought, oh God, what am I going to be shown here? It's a picture of Obi-Wan Kenobi, the Ewan McGregor. And she says, "You look like him." And I said, "Oh, okay." And I just got in my truck and left.
Nice.
That, it was the most awkward conversation. It kind of did, but at the same time, it was so awkward. Sorry, Sam, I didn't mean to interrupt you. Go ahead.
Oh, no, not at all. Not at all. I'll get to my top three. My number three is that really weird scene in where you can tell they've been doing experimentation in Alien Resurrection.
Okay, sure, yeah. Oh, he turned his controller died.
Controller went to sleep.
Yep.
Yeah. So number two?
Yeah, I mean, what do you guess? His number two will be Lost World from Jurassic Park, and his number one will be Jurassic Park somehow.
Yeah.
Or maybe, oh, he left the call. Well, okay, I guess I'll do mine. He's back.
I have resurrected my alien.
Yeah.
On here. So that was my number three.
Yeah.
And I know you guys were making fun of me while I was gone because I could hear you and you couldn't hear me.
That's the best way.
My number two was, I put Truman Show at number two, but kind of see how that wasn't physical.
That's fine, whatever.
You know, experimentation, but it was fun. But my number one is Captain America.
Cool.
Yep.
All right, right on. Yes. Number three for me was The Island of Dr. Moreau.
Ooh, that creepy. Wasn't, who was that famous actor? Was it like one of his last films?
Marlon Brando. Yeah.
Marlon Brando, right?
That movie weirded me out a lot.
Yeah?
Yeah. My number two was Captain America.
Okay.
And honestly, you could pick any of the trilogy, really.
Yeah.
So I'll say
Winter Soldier.
Winter Soldier. I mean, the dude is, you know, he goes through a mind wipe. I mean, he's kind of experimented on, and that's my favorite.
And then Civil War has the rest of them.
Yeah, and honestly, Winter Soldier is my favorite of the trilogy. So I'll pick that one. And my number one
could be the airport fight. That was always.
Yeah, that was a cool scene. Yeah, that was a cool scene. And my number one is Serenity.
Spoiler.
Spoiler?
Spoiler alert.
How is that a spoiler? How is that a spoiler? The Reavers as a result of a experiment.
Yes, but we didn't know that until the very end.
Well, there you go. It's a 14-year-old movie.
The statute of limitations have been lifted on that movie.
It's a 14-year-old movie. Go watch it. Yeah.
Oh, please. Please go watch it.
Yeah.
Maybe they'll make another one.
No, they won't.
Oh, shut up.
They won't. I mean, like, Joss Whedon's come out and said no. Even the actors have said no. Even though, like it was leaked on Twitter, like, literally 2 weeks ago that now that Disney owns Fox, they might be up for a reboot. And some of the actors on Twitter were like, oh, really? We weren't aware of this. Or, you know, so it'll never happen. And that's fine. I'm okay with it. It's perfect.
Wait, what's supposed to happen?
Oh, gosh. Sorry. They're speaking of zombies. We're going to rank this movie. On a scale of
my dog just fell off the couch asleep. Good. Sorry.
He's
wondering where she is right now.
That's what she gets for eating your driver's license.
Yeah.
From one to zero, one to ten. Andrew. Unmute yourself.
Sorry, I was yawning. Not that I'm.
It's just late. We're all tired. It's fine. Go.
Yeah. Go.
Okay. Like I said, I really enjoyed it. It had me at hello. It completed me.
At a zombie hello.
Oh my god! It pulled me off. that's the kind of movie that this was for me. And so I'm going to give it a nice, I don't know. It's definitely rewatchable. So 7.8.
All right. Wow. Yeah. Okay. Cool. Sam.
All right. Well, I saw things I haven't seen before. Even though we've seen this story before, that plane scene is worth the price of admission. Yeah,
that's intense. That's like it's like the plane equivalency of Saving Private Ryan.
I know, right? Holy crap!
Yeah.
So I've got to agree with Andrew here. I'll probably give it a 7.38 out of 10. It's a fun little film. It's not too long, and it's a ride. It's a roller coaster. So.
A good World War II kind of horror flick. I kind of like when you mix genres up a little bit. So this is historical with the horror, you know, like Event Horizon mm-hmm. was space horror. Cowboys and Aliens is sci-fi Western, you know, like I'm okay with mixing up your genres a little bit, and that's fine.
Pride and that's what makes these things interesting, really.
Yeah.
I mean, it's stuff that you've seen, but they twist it in a way that it makes it unique and worth watching.
It's like the movie version of doing like a mashup, like a song mashup.
Yeah.
You know, where you have somebody like Nas X or whatever his name is, and Billy Ray Cyrus, and they make a number one song, you know, like, which my son sings all the time, and it drives me crazy, but anyway.
Oh, dear.
Oh, I have to tell the
what
podcast.
What song is it?
The Country Road song. We're going to change my heart. Old Town Road, yeah.
Anyway. It sounds like Hotel Room.
Something. It's fine. It sucks. I hate it. Yeah.
Wow.
So this is now, someone at my son's school talks like, I got to find it. He literally says this and I hate it. And I keep telling my son to stop saying it, but he literally will say this to me.
Hey, bro.
Yeah.
Somebody at your son's school or your son?
Both. Someone at my son's school taught him that, and my son thinks that that's a cool way to talk. And so literally he's at the playground the other day going,
"Hey, bro,"
to this kid that he's playing with. And I'm like, "Declan, you need to stop saying that." But there's no way I can explain douchebag to a 7-year-old. So we basically just said, you sound kind of dumb when you say that. Like, it's okay to say bro or dude, like,
but you can't say brah.
But just, you can't say,
"Hey, brah."
Oh, God.
Unless you live in California.
I just, if you're doing it to make fun of, like,
Southern California.
Like, if you're doing it ironically to make fun of someone else, fine. But he's 7. He doesn't know that. He thinks it's the cool thing to do. Anyway, I'm giving this movie a 7. I liked it. It was a good time. Ugh.
Hey, bro.
Ugh, jeez. Drives me crazy. All right. Anyway. I don't know. Anyway, that's our show. That's going to do it. My gosh, that was fun. What are we doing next week? I don't know. If only someone had a list in front of them that they could read from.
Yeah. Never had it readily available since, you know, we're in episode number 284.
Yeah. Show notes. Oh, my gosh. When's the last time we had to scream that out?
We almost did tonight with our as far away from the topic as we went.
Yeah, no, that was fine. It was a good time. Heck, I mean, if
that's
I
why
can
we
get,
do this. That's why we do this. I mean, come on.
If I have an opportunity to talk about Star Trek and you know, MCU stuff and not get an eye roll, I'm all over it. So Next week, we are doing something as far away from Nazi zombies as you can get. We are doing A Wrinkle in Time.
Oh. Disney.
Yeah.
Oprah.
Oprah and Captain Kirk and some other people. I know this was a book. I know nothing about it at all. I have no idea.
I was forced to read it in elementary school.
Something about...
Were you really?
Yeah. Mm.
Interesting. Didn't like it. Okay.
Oh, dear.
Mm, we'll see how it goes.
Uh-oh.
will it bring
Andrew
back...
Andrew will tell us all about it.
Yeah. Will it bring back horrible memories or... It's rated PG. It's an hour and 40-something minutes. 48 minutes.
That's too damn long.
It's got a bunch of people in it and...
Chris, they all have hair.
Michael Pena. They all have... Yeah, they do have hair. That's very true. Yeah. So there you go. That's it. That's what we're doing next week. A Wrinkle in Time. Unless Andrew vetoes it. and then in which case we'll do something else. In the meantime, go to our website, cheapseatreviews.com, where you can look at our old catalog of things. Yes, it's not yet done, but I don't have time because I'm busy. Cheapseatreviews@gmail.com is our email address. Leave us a review, iTunes, Google Play, YouTube, any place that you can find us. Stitcher, we're still on Stitcher. iHeartRadio, we're on that also. Instagram, I'm terrible at Instagram. Ooh, somebody just did something. Facebook.com/cheapseatreviews is that, and at cheapseatcast is our Twitter account. And, yeah, please share the show with people that you love or hate. It's just the easiest way to help grow the show. It'd be great as we continue into our sixth year, as we climb ever so closer to 300, our 300th episode. So
we are Sparta.
Looking forward to that. So in the meantime... Check us out. That's great. Appreciate your listenership. You guys are awesome. As you can tell, I'm vamping for the music to end. I should have hit play
except
sooner.
For that one. That
so,
one.
So when I vamp before reading the plot of the movie, I get yelled at.
You're unprepared. I'm vamping because I did a poor job of timing out the music. I mean, yeah. I guess technically I could have just done all this in post, but... It's more fun to sound awkward this way. So on behalf of Andrew and Sam, this is Sean saying thank you and good night. And we wonder why no one listens to our show.
We don't want them listening anyway.